Hello, chess fans. Welcome to another edition of Chess Chat, a program designed to give you, the viewer, a good understanding of the fascinating world of chess. I am George Merejanian, Program Director of the Wachusett Chess Club at Fitchburg State University. This club meets every Wednesday evening from 7 to 11 in room C192 at the McKay Complex at the university. And with me today at the Fitchburg Access Television Production Center is our award-winning director, Darren Dame of Fitchburg. He's assisted in the control room by fellow resident and longtime Wachusett Chess Club member, Brian Bigelow. And across from me is my trusty associate and co-host, Dave Couture of Westminster, one of the strongest chess players in North Central Massachusetts, and also an accomplished chess author. Welcome, Dave, to our edition of Chess Chat.
Glad to be here.
Always good to have you here, Dave. We got to tell our viewers about your latest chess book. You know, we've only had actually, in the history of the Wachusett Chess Club, we've had one other person, one other chess player, who's written chess books. Now this book, Stefan Gerzadowitz. You knew Stefan Gerzadowitz, who lived in East Templeton. Well, can we tell our viewers about your latest book? It just came out, right?
It just came out in paperback.
Okay, it came out in paperback.
It was previously available as a Kindle ebook before that.
Oh, really?
Right.
This book is available on Amazon.
Yep.
So people, if they were to Google your name, Dave Couture, in chess. What's the title of the book?
Progressive Tactics.
Progressive Tactics. And how many tactical positions do you present?
1,002.
1,002.
Yeah.
And your first book got rave reviews, and this book, I have a copy now.
Yeah.
It's a super book.
It's the same. It's the same book, just in a different paperback format.
But you put in how many thousands of hours of labor on this? Anyways, Dave, today we're going to devote our program to the Chess Olympiad. Now, you know what this Chess Olympiad that the World Chess Federation holds every 2 years?
Every 2 years, right.
They just held one the first 2 weeks of September, and it was held in Baku, Azerbaijan.
Yeah.
They've never held an Olympiad. This is the first Olympiad for Baku, Azerbaijan. Who, by the way, Baku is the birthplace of
Garry Kasparov.
Garry Kasparov, former world champion Garry Kasparov was born in Baku. So anyways, but we're doing this program because the U.S. team won the gold medal in this Olympiad. Now, what did you say about the U.S. team, their performance, as far as, had they won this before?
They won it in 76.
40 years ago.
40 years ago.
And that was in Haifa, Israel.
Haifa, Israel, and the Soviet Union was boycotting them. So the Soviet Union was missing all the Eastern Bloc countries.
All
the Arab
countries. The Warsaw Pact countries. Yeah.
Were missing, so.
So it was an easier competition for the U.S. team.
Absolutely.
You'd have to go back to 1937 when there was some sort of competition.
Right.
So the U.S. team had an easier time in 1976.
Right, absolutely.
But this year, they won it, and they were ecstatic. Now, we've got actually some photos of the members of the team. This was they had two sections. This is Wesley So, who played on third board for the U.S. team. He's one of the country's top. And next to him, by the way, behind him, is Ray Robson, who was the fourth board player. He alternated with another player. But this is Wesley So. And here is Hikaru Nakamura, a former multi-time U.S. champion who played on board two.
And he's like number three in the world,
I think he's ranked number three in the world right now. And now we're going to have a picture of our current U.S. champion, Fabiano Caruana, who was born in Miami, Florida, grew up in Brooklyn, New York, played for Italy, but then came back to the United States and now is a U.S. resident again and is our U.S. champion. And he played first board for the U.S. team. And here is Sam Shanklin, who played on fourth board with Ray Robson. They alternated. Ray, by the way, Sam Shanklin here has a Massachusetts connection because he's a graduate of Brandeis University.
Okay. Yep.
So, but now we actually will present the whole team. From left to right, we see they're wearing these hats that they wear in Azerbaijan. From left to right, we have Hikaru Nakamura. Next to him
In the back is John Donaldson, the team captain. He's an international master. And he, by the way, this John Donaldson, the team captain, played in Leominster at the, in the Central Indian Open tournaments back in the 1970s.
Really?
So he's no stranger to chess aficionados in the Fitchburg-Leominster area. Next to him is Sam Shankland holding the trophy. And then next behind him is Ray Robson. And next to him is, ready to clap hands here, is Wesley So. And on the end, not ready to put his hat on yet. Maybe the photographer says, hey, Wesley, get that hat ready. Wesley So is at the far end.
Caruana at the far end.
Oh, no, I'm sorry, Caruana. Fabiano Caruana is the far end. So that's the whole team. Now, they won the gold in the open section. The women's team did not do as well.
Right.
They finished sixth, actually. I think their total, actually, China won the women's section, and the U.S. team finished sixth on tiebreak. But we're going to present a game from the women's section, and let's show actually the pictures of the, this is Nazee Paikidze. She is our current U.S. women's chess champion. She won it in April in St. Louis. We did a program on the U.S. Championship. Now, let's stay on Nazee. Did you realize that Nazee Paikidze, who won that tournament, you know actually who drew her in that tournament?
I'm guessing Carissa.
Our own Carissa Yip, our 2014 Watchers at Chess Club champion, Carissa Yip, drew her in that women's championship in St. Louis.
At the age of 12, right?
At the age of 12,
yeah,
right.
Amazing.
Now, Nazee played on board two for the women's championship. You know who played on board one for the women's?
Irina Krush.
Irina Krush.
Right.
Now, Irina Krush is our top-rated. She's a multi-time U.S. women's champion. We don't have a photo of her. But you know actually who defeated her in the U.S. Women's Championship?
That would be Carissa again.
Our own Carissa Yip defeated Irina Krush. Now we have a game that we're going to present with Nazee Paikidze playing in a match against the team from Norway. We have a picture actually of the player she played against. And this is Olga Dolzhikova, who was born in Ukraine, but actually has taken up Norway as her country of residence. Mm-hmm. She now plays for Norway, and she played actually on the Norwegian team. And you found this game from the tournament that we're going to present to our viewers. So, and by the way, she is a women grandmaster, just as Nazee is a women grandmaster. Mm-hmm. Also, Nazee is also an international master. She has two titles, women grandmaster and international master. But Olga is a woman grandmaster, 37 years old. By the way, Nazee is going to turn 23 in a couple of weeks. I think October 27th is her 23rd birthday. So we wish Nazee a happy birthday in advance. So let's present this game to our viewers, where Olga had white against Nazee. And how did Olga open the game?
She opens with e4. Standard.
Very standard. One of the most popular opening moves.
Yeah.
That's been played for hundreds of years. What Nazee responded with was c6. C6. Now, what is this? I don't know. Have we presented actually any game with this response?
I don't think we have.
If we have, it's been a long time. But what is this? What is this response of c6? What is this defense known as?
It's called the Caro-Kann.
Caro-Kann. Now, we have players at the club who play this. I think of Gary Broussard is one who's played this.
And Diego Ubiera, who
won
the last
Diego
tournament.
Yes, Diego Ubiera. By the way, let's mention to our viewers that we have a new member at the Watchers of Chess Club. He's an assistant professor of English, Diego Ubiera, who is away from chess nearly 12 years. He had not played in Raid Chess in 12 years. And he came back. He was surprised to learn that there is a chess club at Fitchburg State. He was ecstatic when he found out. And he won the tournament that we just concluded, the Rocco R. Pasquale Memorial, which is in honor of one of the founders of the Watchers Chess Club, Rocco Pasquale. But Diego was a Caro Kann player.
Right? Right, he played it against me and beat me.
Oh, he beat you playing Caro Kann? Yeah. Anyway, so this is the Caro Kann, known worldwide as the Caro Kann defense. So how did Nazi play her next move? What did she do?
This is Olga.
Olga had white. Olga, right. What did she play?
She plays knight to c3.
Okay, what? Although, normally,
this is 80% of the time people play d4.
D4, right.
But she played knight to c3.
Okay. So what Nazi continued with on her second move was d5. This is all standard in this Caro Kann. If you play c6, you're going to follow up with d5.
Right.
Okay, now third move for Olga.
Olga plays knight f3.
Now, what is this? Now, we have two knights out. You know what this is called?
Yeah, just the two knights variation.
It's called
variation.
A two-knight variation against the Caro Kann defense. Okay, so in response to this, what Nazi played, now she could have exchanged the pawns here.
Yeah.
The D takes the pawn on e4, or she could have actually developed a knight, this knight to f6. These are all playable moves.
Right.
But she played bishop g4, pinning the knight.
Yeah.
By the way, I should mention actually this two-knight variation that Olga is playing, you know who played this in his youth? Bobby Fischer.
Okay.
If our viewers were to go online and Google the chess games of Robert Fischer, they will find many games where Bobby Fischer in the late 57 through the 60s played this as a youngster. He eventually abandoned the two knights variation as white, but that was very popular with him back in the late 50s and early 60s. All right, so what did Olga do on her fourth move?
She plays h3.
Oh, she's putting the question to the bishop.
Right.
So the bishop has to decide, do we retreat or do we take the knight? And she took the knight. Bishop takes f3 is Nazi's move, her fourth move, okay? So now, how do we take back here?
And Olga recaptures by developing the queen.
Right, exactly. So she's ahead in development. Yeah.
Right.
Okay, so queen takes f3. Now Nazi plays e6. Now it's okay to play e6, which is going to eventually opens up actually for the diagonal for the dark squared bishop. Now what does Olga do next?
She plays d3.
Okay. Now this move, d3, shuts in that light squared bishop, I see.
Right,
okay.
Right.
So that may be one of the, there's a shortcoming.
Right.
Yeah. You know, in the opening, moves actually have both advantages and disadvantages? Here's a classic
Pretty
example.
Pretty much, yeah, always.
Yeah, exactly. Always, always. Okay, so after d3, Nazi played knight f6. That was her sixth move. All right, Olga's move. What does she
plays
do?
Plays bishop to d2.
Okay, bishop to d2.
Developing the bishop and clearing the way to castle,
right
inside.
Now she puts it there. Now I know some players would bring that bishop all the way out to g5 and pin the knight.
Sure, yeah.
I'm sure there are those players who would do something like that. But I think Olga wants to have that bishop so in a position where it can operate on both sides of the board.
Right.
From that position.
Yeah.
Okay, so after bishop d2, Nazi plays knight bd7. Her seventh move. Knight goes to d7 from b8. So, what does theory recommend here? Is there a theoretical next move for white in this position? I mean, this position has been played,
probably thousands of
times before. Is there something that theoreticians have agreed on could be played or should be played in this position?
Normally white plays g4.
With the threat of?
Of pushing to g5, attacking the knight.
And forcing the knight actually to retreat back to
all the way back.
The g8.
Right.
All right, but Olga did not do that. What she did?
She castled immediately.
Okay. All right, so this allowed Nazi to advance the pawn on her eighth move to d4. D4 now attacks the knight on c3.
Mm-hmm.
That knight has to move. Where does that knight go?
Knight to e2.
Okay.
Which is attacking.
All right, so now it's a threatening to take the pawn, which is undefended right now.
Right.
So knight e2. So what, well, is there something the theory recommended here that black can do here in response? How do we defend that pawn? There's different ways we can defend that pawn. We could actually push a pawn to c5. We could bring a bishop to c5.
Right.
But what Nazi did was play queen b6. The queen now has a dual purpose. It not only defends the pawn on